it's Suzanne O'Brien, and welcome to this episode of Ask a Death Doula. Today, as you can see, I have a very special guest. This is Michael Hebb. He has a very long resume, so I'm going to highlight a few things, and then we're going to get right into the conversation because we have some super exciting news to share with you, and let's just take it away. So I just want to share that Michael Hebb, for a lot of you who know what I do, you probably know Death Over Dinner, and he is the founder of Death Over Dinner. And he also has a book out. And now what he's doing is he is again on this international platform, but we're gonna talk about a conference that's coming up this April in Washington. And also he has another special announcement. So we're gonna kind of let this conversation show you what we're going to be talking about. So Michael, thank you so much for being here.
Oh, it's great to be here.
Okay, so the first thing I wanna just talk about is your background a little bit. And why was this subject matter important to you? Why was death something that you felt strongly about to educate and be part of?
Well, now, and do you want me to be looking at these lovely people or over at you?
Whichever,
a little bit of both?
A little bit of both.
Okay. Just want to make sure that I'm doing like the other people who've been on the podcast. So my background is actually as an architect.
And
which a lot of people find surprising. Given...
Makes perfect sense to me.
No, yeah, right. And I think that, you know, I came at it from this perspective of the importance of design. And which has always been really essential to me since I was a child. But I lost my father when I was in, when I was 13. And he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's when I was in second grade. So at a very young and impressionable age, I got to experience what it means to deal with a terminal diagnosis and how, what an impact that has on the family.
Can I ask you, in that in that space, did somebody guide you? Did somebody sit down and talk to you? Were you able to have a conversation with your father early on about what was happening, or how did that all look? What did that look like? Because you talk about design.
No, it was a nightmare.
Okay.
You know, and so sometimes the best designs come from nightmares.
100%.
And not wanting to have anybody experience what you had to experience.
I love that.
And so what I, my childhood experience of it was having no guidance from a parental side or from a mentor side or from a psychological or therapy side. And it was a disaster. He was angry. Confused, he wasn't well communicated to, and then he was overdrugged in terrible institutions, and he died, you know, in a, some sort of strange assisted care foster home situation.
And it was,
was, the memorial was painful and bad, and there wasn't closure, and I didn't know how to talk to anybody. My friends, I remember he died on Halloween, and I actually went out. On Halloween night with you know, my 13-year-old friends, and Halloween is like a party night, right?
Yeah.
Like, especially when you're 13, you're getting into a lot of trouble on Halloween if you're that type of kid. And I remember so distinctly being out with my friends and realizing that there was not, there was no one that I could share this information with. I mean, my father had just died.
Yeah.
And I didn't have the confidence that anybody in my friend group would have the skills or the ability to hold that kind of weight, and so I didn't try it,
right? Yeah,
and it created this this distance between me and my friend group, which didn't it just grew, and that was actually that differentiation between me and my friends, even though it was lonely and hard, and I went through some depression and things. It's actually where I think where my greatest gifts started to come from, because instead of like being interested or just moving along with the flow, with what everybody was expected of them and convention, etc., I was suddenly asking questions that nobody else.
You became
was
a seeker.
Yeah, and so you know, that's when I got interested in spirituality and meditation and, you know,
trying to make sense of it all.
So it was, you know, everybody has this kind of genesis story in this work that, and a part of them has to die. sure. You know, for them to really want to be able to do this.
I think it's so beautiful to again take experiences, and sometimes I joke about how I feel like my whole training was built on what not to do. You know, sure. And I have a very vast training. But I think it's so beautiful to understand that, you know, our painful experiences can really lead us to a higher, although very hard to understand that when we're going through it.
Yeah.
But if you could go back and that young boy, what would have helped at that point? What would you have needed that you feel would have helped, so we can kind of share that information right now if somebody's in that same...
Yeah, well, so a lot of things. I mean, it's a long list, but I'll take like the top three or four. One is making it clear that things are only going to get, it's going to become only more difficult to communicate with my father, right? Mm-hmm. That there would be moments of total clarity. And to talk openly about the fact that, you know, the progression of his dementia, what it would look like. Mm-hmm. And the primary function there is just open conversation. Mm-hmm. The lack of it turned it into a shameful thing. Mm-hmm. And so I ended up being ashamed of my sick father, right? Ashamed of, and embarrassed by him even when there wasn't an audience, right?
Right.
Which is just, you know, I'm sure it caused him immense pain that we weren't connecting when he had the opportunity to connect.
Yeah.
And I saw him very little, and I didn't, there was no like taking advantage of the potential joy and beauty. It was just pain, right? It was just drudgery and pain and disappointment and shame. And so, an honest conversation and then therapy.
Absolutely.
Like immediately, if your child, if, you know, if a child is going to lose a parent from a terminal diagnosis, like put that child in therapy immediately. Because I'm a parent. I don't have the skills for that. You know, I work in this space deeply. And and if I was in that situation where the person, you know, one of my children's, you know, mother or myself, et cetera, had a terminal diagnosis, I'm not going to try to handle that myself.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, and you shouldn't have to feel it. You have to. I mean, you need your own support.
Absolutely.
And also, I feel like it sometimes is very beneficial for a third party to come in that's neutral, that does not have the history, that can be there. And I often think that our presence is some of the best medicine we can give one another. And that, because you're not going to fix it. Right. I'm not here to fix it. What can I say? But there are tools, but also just to be that presence that I see you, and I'm here for you. You tell me what you need.
Yeah.
So I think it's absolutely beautiful and really, really means a lot that you were at that tender age that you started seeking. And, you know, no doubt he's a little bit ahead of his time now. You know, he's like a powerhouse, this man. So it makes perfect sense it started at like 13. So you gifted, you know, this, your father, like in his honor, and what you're doing is so beautiful so that other people do not suffer in that same place. So with that being said, death over dinner, how did that come about?
Yeah, so that actually came through architecture. So I studied architecture and I went to architecture school and started a firm right out of architecture school. And I realized, and we were doing really cool community-based work and some guerrilla architecture work, doing illegal, like...
You heard it here.
Yeah. Some really like fun illegal installations of kind of architectural sculptures in Portland. That's a whole different topic. But what I realized was architecture was a really inefficient way to create human experience. So the goal of architecture, especially what I studied, was about shaping human lives and creating powerful human experiences, like and a environment that brings out the best of us, right? And in a kind of like Corbusier or Frank Lloyd Wright sort of way. And then it occurred to me that that's a very long route to creating experience, to go find $100 million to build a you know, monument to the human experience, or even $1 million for a house or whatever. The dinner table is sitting in most of our apartments and living places. We don't necessarily know how to use it often. Mm-hmm. We usually pile, you know, mail
with
on
other
it
stuff,
or
yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Place for homework. Mm-hmm. But the table is one of the oldest and maybe the first architecture. It's like maybe the first third place, right?
Okay.
First intentional
yeah.
space for a convivial social activity.
Yep.
It's a dinner table.
Yep.
And when we go from just like stealing knives into roast meat over a fire
yeah.
to
yeah.
the intentionality of putting it in a place where we're going to share something.
Mm-hmm.
And when we sit down to a dinner table, it doesn't matter. The architecture is often irrelevant, mm-hmm. right? If the mm-hmm. conversation and the food mm-hmm. and the human connection is strong enough,
mm.
and really it's the human connection piece.
Mm.
You're transported outside of time and
mm-hmm.
outside of place,
mm-hmm.
outside of architecture,
mm-hmm.
and you're definitely in the realm of powerful human experience, right? And so I was like, I don't need buildings. I just need
Wait a minute, we could do this.
let me focus on the table
yeah.
as a kind of social architecture.
Mm-hmm.
to understand how it works. And so I spent 20 years in a deep investigation of the dinner table.
Because who doesn't like to eat a good
right.
meal too?
Right.
I mean, who's gonna say no?
Right.
But I think there's so much here because you're absolutely right. But I feel like that's one of the things that we're missing in our modern day society is that getting together physically anywhere. I mean, even families don't do that. And then there's the other part about the nourishing segment of it.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm gonna sit down with you and we're gonna have a feast and get in that place of, you're right, time and space, it all kind of goes away, we can almost approach any subject.
That's right. You're not,
yeah.
The likelihood of being in fight or flight or freeze
right.
Is really low
yeah.
in, at yeah. a dinner. So it depends on if maybe you were traumatized at a dinner table or maybe you're at dinner table with people who put you on edge. I mean, a lot of that, given the right conversation mm-hmm. the right topic, even if it's people that you have very difficult dynamics with, can break through the dinner.
Yeah.
Like the ritual is more powerful than the individual.
I agree. Yeah.
And I mean, I wanted to start bringing you know, warring states together,
mm-hmm.
Heads of state
mm-hmm.
Around the dinner table. I mean, I've been able to bring heads of state together at dinner. But not in active conflict.
Right.
And I think that we could actually, like, you couldn't unexperience the level of human connection that would be felt at those tables.
I
and
agree.
It would impact the geopolitics of our day, but we don't have to go all
no,
the way.
No, but
there.
I mean, but the foundation is there, and it's so important to understand that there is, again, these common ways that we can come together, but it reminds us that we all are human beings, and when we feel that connection and lower our, you know, our guard,
mm-hmm.
We all really are going for the same goals. We all want to be loved. We want our families to do well, right?
Yeah.
You know, so I think it's beautiful. So this turned into an international sensation. I know you have a lot of different parts of it, including now with healthcare. Is that right? You have
yeah.
something for...
Yeah, so we launched Death Over Dinner 8 years ago, and the idea was how it was designed because I wanted to pick a topic, and it was the beginning of what would be many topics, but where people could have a meaningful conversation, potentially a transformative conversation
mm-hmm.
at scale.
Mm-hmm.
So dinner table and a dinner invitation is finite, right?
Mm-hmm.
We got one, it's got
mm-hmm.
edges,
mm-hmm.
doesn't work
yep.
to have 1,000 people in conversation at a table.
Yeah.
6 to 8 people, like, but how do you scale that, right?
Sure.
How do you scale
yeah.
the finite? And so it's like, let's create this very beautiful dinner platform that gives people enough, like gives them almost like a board game, like
yep.
So that they know exactly what to do in this difficult conversation, so they know they feel held.
Right.
And they have a blamable third party. Which is very important. Like, board games are like, if you don't like the board game, you don't blame your mom.
Okay.
Right? You're like, God, I don't
okay.
like Monopoly.
Right.
But the idea of a game is everybody likes, right?
Yeah.
So this crazy idea of sitting down and having death, a conversation over dinner, hit this nerve. And there's been over 1 million people who sat down and had death dinners. And then we have been iterating on it. We built a Jewish edition. We're actually working on a Christian faith edition.
It's beautiful.
With one of the leading faith-based colleges in the United States. But there's a healthcare edition that has really started, just launched, but the impact is huge. We're working with, just down the street, with Memorial Sloan Kettering here in New York, and they're in this lengthy process of having, you know, possibly all of their clinicians go through.
And they should.
Yeah, I mean, I don't use the should word, but I like that you are. Yeah.
And I can, and I want to speak to this for a minute, because I really want to talk about, within the healthcare system, our amazing people that work within the system, the doctors, the nurses, the aides, everybody. Everyone is suffering from this lack of a healthy relationship with end of life, which is part, a natural part of the journey. Like, how did we get here? And so our clinicians are right now, in my opinion, what I've seen, they're expected to fix this. And having this conversation, they're not even given the time to have an end of life conversation, because it's just, there's so many patients and all the regulations. So for us to be able to say, hey, we see what you're going through as well. We have to do this together. I always say we have to move forward in this together. But it, I think a lot of it is us, people. I have to make my decisions ahead of time. I have to say, one day, end of life will be a part of my journey. Yeah. So how do I want to live? And I feel like that's a big part of your focus, what you want to be doing.
Yeah, well, that speaks to the platform we're about to launch. But let me tell you one story about the healthcare edition that really illustrates the importance of it. And, you know, we did want to get to the people that are on the front lines. One, if I can change the way that end of, or doctors and clinicians and practitioners feel about death, and their literacy on the topic, and their comfort level, and then their skill, right? But first there's comfort and literacy before there's skill. And if we can change that, the experience of countless patients will be changed, right? And so that was our model. But, you know, D is a bad, you know, the D word is a bad word in healthcare.
Yes, in healthcare, yeah.
Yeah, and so I found myself, and it took us 8 years knocking on the door of the American medical establishment to get in. And now our partners are Memorial Sloan Kettering, the Cleveland Clinic, and really the most respected healthcare systems in the world. And I found myself hosting a dinner for 20 heart surgeons at the Cleveland Clinic, where they were the first successful heart surgery was performed at the Cleveland Clinic.
Wow.
And so, and this was the lineage of some of those doctors, some of them in their 80s, et cetera, and their care teams. Okay. So not only do you have, you know, the head of cardiothoracic surgery, but you have the head of cardiothoracic anesthesiology and the head nurse and the palliative care that they tend to tell to leave the room because they're saving lives, not ending them, right? So there's a lot of tension, and they're like, who is this guy and why are we doing this death dinner? And they look at me as we're starting the dinner, and I'm explaining what we're about to go through. And I said, you know, just for tonight, I want us to think about medicine in a slightly different way. So undoubtedly you practice medicine, no question. And you practice medicine to stave off death, right? And to reduce human suffering. I think that, you know, that's non-controversial.
Right.
And I was like, for tonight, I want you to actually imagine the death itself and the topic, that that is medicine. Right. And it has a whole psycho-spiritual, but also a physiological impact on your patients and their ability to heal once they're done, you know, or their family's ability to heal if they don't make it. And so, you know, and that, like, you could feel like the air
all of a sudden.
The they were like, okay,
where's the door?
No, they were like, we're going to listen to this guy.
Well, I think I was going to ask you, did they feel relieved?
Oh, well, undeniably, there was not a dry eye in that room. And what what we got to see was, because I had full care teams at tables together.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of just having a table of doctors,
right?
This was, you know, the physician's assistant and the nurse and the attending. All,
so you could hear everyone's perspective.
Yeah, and to watch the chairman, Nicholas Skubas of Cardiothoracic, talk about, you know, the death of a family member crying and watch the hierarchy and the dynamics and the softening change, I knew that those care teams were going to respond to each other, react to each other, treat each other as in a different way going forward. You, like, it was this gestalt therapy that you see at almost every death dinner, dependent upon how connected people are.
Yeah.
It happens with strangers too, but if you see, if you sit down with a family,
yeah,
you literally watch, you know their dynamic's gonna shift.
Mm-hmm.
Their dynamic.
Yeah.
Not, you know, not their, and you see this all the time with your work, that you're actually not seeing a instance change, you're seeing a dynamic which can
It's an energetic whole. Yeah.
And that can impact generations.
Absolutely.
Right? Like,
I mean, and I think that, It's absolutely beautiful, but think about what terminology we're using in the medical world, which, I'm sorry, there's no more I can do for you. I lost my battle with. I mean, we're setting this up. There is so much we can do for patients at the end, at that end phase. There's that might be the most important time that we care for people. So this is extremely empowering to shift the way, the perspective, and also the tools that we support doctors with.
Yeah.
So that's great, because we have to do that. We have to support them. It's really challenging. So I want to ask you, what is going on in April in Washington?
Oh, yeah, okay.
And also, where is this concept from? It's beautiful. It's called Love and Death. I always talk about how it's one. You know, death is not over there. Death is part of life. If I'm talking about life, I'm going to be talking about death and vice versa. So share with me the Love and Death concept. What's happening, how people get involved?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
We'll start with a love story.
Okay.
So my book, Let's Talk About Death, came out last year.
Okay.
And I was in town, I was in New York, not too far from here, doing an event at Habitas. And it was a conversation between me and Mama Gina, Regina Thomas-Hauer. And her most recent book is Pussy, A Reclamation. And so,
and we're not going to edit that out. No,
okay. Like, you might.
No, I'm not.
And she, New York Times bestseller.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
And so we were like, great, we're going to talk about death and pussy tonight, which really, that was at Reimagine in October of whatever last year. And so we had a really exciting conversation, as you can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of it, Dr. Jordana Jacobs came up to me and said, you know, I'm really a bit nervous meeting you because your work means a lot to me. And she started to explain why. And instead of kind of the more regular conversations I have with people about the loss that they've had, it was that she was a clinical psychologist. She did her doctoral research on the connection between love and death, and looked at, which was groundbreaking research. She doesn't agree with me how groundbreaking it is, but nonetheless, that looked at the fact that if we willingly face our mortality, if we're primed for death, primed for our mortality, that we actually increase our capacity to love in a variety of ways.
Yeah,
which
I agree, 100%.
Yeah, and there's no question
that
from a practical, embodied, anecdotal, spiritual lineage sense of that, but it doesn't exist in the psychological canon, or it didn't until she did this research.
Okay.
There's a lot of work that has been done around terror management theory and defending against death and our anxiety.
Exactly.
But there's not
like what a great tool it is.
Embrace it.
Right.
And get
death is like, your should be your friend, your best friend.
Yes.
Teaches you how to, and this is so interesting because
maybe an aphrodisiac. Right.
And maybe an aphrodisiac. Okay. But it is really true. And I think, again, this is only the last 100 years that we have lost our complete relationship with death being part of the journey. And look at the destruction that's all around us. And I swear that a major part of that is the denial that one day this journey will be over. But when you do listen to people at the end of life, the love, the wisdom, how real it gets, and it lets everyone in that dynamic walk out the door with a whole different perspective about their life.
Yeah.
It's one of the greatest gifts that we can have. So I agree. So I love the work that she does. I think you're right that it's groundbreaking, and I agree. So you came up now with this conference that you're going to have.
Yeah. So here we are at the book launch, and I say we need to have tea tomorrow because I need to know more. And so we have tea the next day, and I was like, we have to work together, because this is in the same way that when I learned how badly we die in the United States, and the statistic that 80% of us die at home. And only 80% of us die in hospitals, and only 20% of us, 80% of women die at home, and only 20% of us do.
Right.
That created death over dinner. Mm-hmm. And then when I heard about Jordana's research, I was like, we need to create a gathering called Love and Death. And so we did a retreat last year in April in upstate New York. And it was so successful that we decided to bring it to a major stage in Seattle. Mm-hmm. And so we created a conference called Love and Death that Susan is coming to speak at. And so it's BJ Miller and Shoshana Berger and Shoshana Ungerleiter, a lot of Shoshanas.
Yeah, that's good.
And Ira Byock and Eric Weinstein and Alex Benayan, a very long list.
Yeah, of amazing people.
Of amazing people.
It's wonderful.
And there'll be about 16 fireside chats at Town Hall Seattle, which is this iconic venue in the middle of Seattle, and it's a love or relationship expert paired with an end of life expert, essentially different variations of that through the 2 days, and then about 20 community events, including a World Training Day, level one training, and a bunch of other things. People are going to be able to design and even be able to make with a ceramicist their own urn.
Love it.
There's a Love and Death, a night of Love and Death songs hosted, will include members of like the band The Head and the Heart and like incredible Seattle musicians that are hard to get, it's to see in major venues. So it's really kind of more like an ideas festival. And kind of reminiscent of Reimagine, but it all happens within a 3-block radius.
Okay.
On First Hill in Seattle over just 3 days.
Beautiful.
So yeah, and we don't, we're gonna, oh, and that's the, we get announced.
I know, yeah, I was gonna, okay. I didn't forget.
So Love and Death at round.glass. And I'm sure
we're going to put all the links for you guys.
Yeah. So that's in April, and there's still tickets available that will sell out.
Yeah.
And it'll be live cast. Chase Jarvis and Creative Live are going to live cast
it. Okay.
But then we just confirmed today.
Today, hot off the press. Yeah, okay.
That we are going to host Love and Death New York for 2 days, June 12th and 13th, as part of Reimagine. But in partnership with Memorial Sloan Kettering at their Rockefeller Auditorium, I believe.
Yep, sounds right.
And this
is incredible.
Yeah.
I always say this end of life movement is happening in dog years, might even be light years, because it's incredible how the universe is bringing everyone together, and really everyone's coming together.
Yeah.
It's like magic.
Well, and here's the thing is we, not only is MSK, Memorial Sloan Kettering, doing death dinners with all those clinicians, but to partner in, host, and co-MC, the head of their patient advisory committee, Frank Licardi, is going to co-host a mini conference that is called Love and Death, right? So,
right.
I mean, this was my hope for this work, is that when somebody has the unfortunate, experience and beginning of a journey of hearing that they have a terminal diagnosis, that they are able to, that we're able to do them the great honor of acknowledging the death is in the room.
Mm-hmm.
The moment that diagnosis hits, I don't care what stage it is.
Right.
Obviously, the higher the stage, the more present it
is.
But death as an elephant is very much in the room. It's in the room for all of our loved ones. It's in the room for everyone you talk about, and if you don't turn towards it and acknowledge it,
make friends with it.
Make friends with it. If you know, I mean, and I don't even, That's brave, but...
Well, I don't, can I just share with you that I feel, again, when people always ask me what makes a good end of life, and again, end of life doulas coming in and doing that, yes, it's absolutely wonderful to come in there, but a good end of life starts way back here with this conversation. So for me, if we are living with the awareness, again, even our doctors having the conversation, that one day... whatever that looks like, whether it's a cancer diagnosis or just, that'll be part of the journey, that when I get there, that I'm living with that awareness, and that's, this is the time.
Yeah.
It's not a shell shocker like it is now, which is super, it's compounding so much that fear.
No, that's a good definition of a good death, because I don't like that terminology. What is it makes a good death, right? Mm-hmm. And the good death movement and all of this, I kind of I don't want to, have a bad death. Have a whatever death. I don't want people to feel like they have to achieve even, at the death. But I like if this is the yardstick that making friends with your death, if that's a definition of a good death, I think that that's something I can get.
Well, here's the thing. Unless anyone knows any different, tell me, it's 100% that it's going to be part of each and every one of our journeys.
Of course.
So I'm thinking that... And here's the other thing I think that's super important is that it can go well, but it's your journey. And it's my journey. But, again, the fear of death, which is the second leading fear in this country, I often say to people, what is that fear? Because that fear is so palpable and is destroying and it's causing so much suffering. And I feel it's just the elephant in the room of not talking about this at all.
Yeah.
And then when it shows up, it's like, what do we do now?
Yeah.
We shut down.
Yeah, no, if it's an enemy, you're in trouble because then it's stalking you or it's glowering at you.
But love and death, you kind of are bringing that right together in a beautiful way.
Yeah, it's just when you bring these two things in, instead of saying, through death I gained X or through love I gained, just putting them on equal platform and saying, what can we learn when we're looking through the prismatic view of these two things together, because it's not as a serious kind of ideas symposium or festival. It's not commonly done, and I don't know of another instance of saying let's elevate it to this level. It also makes it a lot more approachable, because there's a lot of, if you say to people we're doing a death conference, you really limit your, or even end of life or et cetera. But if you say no, we're really looking at love, and we're really looking at death too.
And there is a relationship between the two. There really is. Like, trust, there is. So that's, it's beautiful. I think this is going to be so iconic. And I know so many people are jumping on and they're just getting their tickets to Seattle.
Oh, yeah.
And now that you're announcing New York, we'll put all of those links down below. And please get your tickets because they will sell out. So exciting what you're doing. And again, I feel like just raising the awareness for people plant seeds. So now I want for you to share the platform that you've built, that you are building, that is so exciting, that can really change the face of healthcare and what's really happening out there.
That's very kind. And I'm excited too. While it is great to have these conversations, while Death Over Dinner has been very successful and Death Cafes, and working with individual families, how do we get to everybody? And how do we get to families when they're in need? When you're experiencing an end-of-life event, what you turn to Google, and then you have to become an expert, right? And maybe you do find a doula, and they guide you through it, but, there's a... the vast majority of people don't have that, aren't utilizing that resource yet, right? And so we realized that we've helped raise the literacy, and so people can now make empowered decisions. And so it started about 5 years ago, but it really intensified in the last 3 years, and then we now have a team of about 50 people working on it within the last year, and we launch at Love and Death a platform called EOL.
Okay.
Called the End of Life Collective is its long name. And we've designed it as a platform for for the best end of life practitioners service providers. For them to connect in a safe and secure community.
Mm-hmm.
It's built on a social network platform. And so they can connect so that they can then also help others. So that we all connect on various platforms.
Right.
But I was like, we need our own for this work.
Yeah.
And it needs to be a social platform where people, when they're in need, can come into.
Mm-hmm.
But it needed a few other components, because if it was just a nice social network, that would be a lot of resources, but more like go here and find that.
Yeah.
So we wanted to have the best content. So mm-hmm. we've been building a lot of our own, but also, you know, we'll be working with all of the best content providers in the end of life space. Like the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross Foundation was like, let's give you all of our archives. Let's give you all of our content and make this the home for it. And, you know, we've heard that since we've been talking to people from countless organizations that create incredible content. And then also the marketplace of service providers. So that right now, again, Google is your best tool other than having a doula that can guide you through it. We wanted to have, whether it was financial advice and planning, mm-hmm. estate planning, mm-hmm. insurance for advanced care or for life insurance, hospices, advanced care, you know, assisted care facilities,
mm-hmm.
all the way onto death care to bereavement and grief, mm-hmm. therapists, doulas, all in one place mm-hmm. That felt like home to them, where people could find their services. And so we've built it, and it's really pretty. I mean, you've seen it.
I did. Yeah. It's really good. Yeah. It's really needed, because I always say time is not on our side at end of life. And when people are given that, you know, diagnosis or the, you know, sometimes they don't even know who the players are in the hospice team, let alone, because everything is so much. But I love having them all in one place and having such great quality that you're offering. And again, soup to nuts. So, because there's a lot of different avenues that come along with that, in the incredible natural burial and just different options like cremations and all of that, that you want.
And you can educate yourself, you can talk to experts, and then you can actually,
community.
And you can, you know, purchase the service.
So that's so exciting. When will that be available?
So that launches April 25th, and the URL, it's not live right now, but it will be eol.community.
Okay.
And then the other thing that it does is it learns about you through a quiz and through some other onboarding bits, but mm-hmm. it learns where you're at in your journey, and then you have two options. One, the technological platform can just tell you everything that you haven't done and you should or could do.
Right.
It's a complete kind of your mission control. So it's not just a checklist. It's a full 360 degree, here's all of the things that you can complete to be like a good death citizen.
Okay.
More or less.
Okay.
end of life citizen and be ready. So, or you can push a button and have a doula there to do case management for you or your family, which will be really critical when somebody is having a hard time and maybe you're not in a place that has a doula or you're still trying to find one.
Yep.
But to have somebody remote who knows this work and has been trained that can walk a family through making these decisions instead of just calling, you know, going to a Dignity Memorial and say, make all the decisions for me. It's not necessarily the best
way. Having a navigator and somebody to guide you is perfect. So I will share with you, and I know that you'll probably understand this, is that 90% end of lives go better by 90% if people have planned ahead.
Yeah.
Whatever disease that is, it doesn't really matter. It's the planning ahead and having your end of life as much as, you know, in control of what you wanted. But the logistics of it, super important. 90% the end of life is better, and you're going to have that in one place. And I think that's absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
So we are going to put all the links down below that you can access.
Sorry.
It's just a movement's happening, and you're, you know, one of the most progressive people out here doing it. So I want to thank you so much for being on the podcast, for the work that you do. And again, being a guest on Ask a Death Doula, this is Michael Hebb. And please come to the Love and Death Conference, Seattle, the 24th of April to the 26th, and New York City,
June 12th through 13th.
Okay, we'll see you then.
Bye.
Thank you so much. See you in the next episode.